We'll call the Union 38 committee meeting, joint committee meeting, to order at 6:09.
So Frontier, we need to approve the Frontier Regional minutes from October 6th of 2016. I have a motion from Phil. I have a second from Bill.
Which Bill?
Mayor Peasy.
All right. Who's the first?
Phil Cantor. Hearing no discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Oppose, and then you have the two.
Yep, got it.
Okay.
I'd entertain a motion to approve the minutes for the Union 38.
So moved.
Second.
I didn't catch that. Okay. Any discussion or comments? Voting members on? Opposed? Looks like it's unanimous. So.
So we'll be moving on to the public comment. I know Mr. William Deal from the Collaborative is here to talk to us about the services they offer. So we're going to put him right now in the public comment so that he can then leave our crazy meeting. And welcome. And I think is it William or Bill or?
Bill.
Bill's fine? Okay.
So I've been meeting all the school committees and school part of the Collaborative. That's 36 school committees. I typically start out by thanking the members of the CAS board, current and former. If I did that, I spent all my 10 minutes thanking people. Because in the room are a lot of friends and former and current board members. You guys have been tremendous supporters of the Collaborative. And I hope we have done as well. And Superintendent Terry has been a really strong supporter of the meetings and a very good advocate for the Collaborative. But I won't spend time thanking so many friends here. I do recognize Mr. Decker, who's been a longtime friend and supporter, as well as all the current ones as well. So I wanted to have four different parts of my agenda, and I'll try to be brief since we have a large agenda ourselves. The first thing is just to talk about the Collaborative generally, a quick overview of what Collaboratives are, assuming some of you don't know what we are. And secondly, to talk about the service we provide, especially service we provide to your districts, and thirdly, to talk about some of the upcoming things that are happening, and lastly, to see if there are questions or ideas for us. Our number one mission is to serve our member districts, and so we're always looking for ideas about how we can serve you better, help you save costs, do a better job of professional development, special education, and so on. So I like ideas for that. So, first thing is, what are Collaboratives? Many of you may know, I'll give a quick overview. We were formed in the 1970s. As were all Collaboratives in the Commonwealth, 26 of us. As in 48 other states, these were formed as well. They're all formed because the laws on special education changed in 1974. 94-102 was passed then. And all of a sudden, districts didn't have the capacity to educate the kids the way the law required. And so they formed Collaboratives so they could have kids come together to stand similar special needs and be served across districts. Over time, appropriately, those services were brought in-house. We want to educate kids at their home, with their peers, as much as possible. That's happened over time. So it became less and less of a special education service, and more professional development, after-school programming, early child education, and so we really expanded our service. But our roots are in special education, and we saw a lot of passion in that. So in your folders, the folder itself, I didn't have enough, I really apologize. The folder itself describes the services. The back cover lists the 36 members of the district. The first thing inside your folder is a colorful chart, which basically describes just this year, starting September until now, the services your districts have used. So between Heck Academy, which is Special Education Academy, or Hampton, you have today, one, two, two, three, one, I don't know how many. But we also have special education services from us, a lot of professional development, as you can see, a lot of advantage of that. Some technical assistance, you've been part of some of our grants we developed, including the keyboard you've been part of. A lot of technology assistance. We do a lot with early childhood, even though most of it's New Hampshire County, you guys also benefit from a lot of that with mental health services and so on. Enrichment programs, probably in New Hampshire County, but we're willing to talk to you about those. and cooperative purchasing, currency regional service, does if you don't, if not, it's part of that. So these are all quick summary of the services, and I wonder if anyone has any questions about these, or any kind of surprise to you, you kind of familiar with the different things that you do. Take a second for that. Okay? So we are funded primarily by grants and contracts, so a lot of these services, much as possible, we try to provide for free by getting grants from the feds and the state to help do those. Where we can, we have low cost, development, special education, and so on. So our goal is really to help districts save funds and have the most effective and efficient services we can. So that's an overview of the services. Going quickly because of your agenda. There are many things coming up, and one of them is our summer academy, and this is fresh off the presses. We don't have enough of these either. This is happening this summer. You may have seen the chart that summer academy wasn't checked anywhere because the chart started in September. Hopefully this will be all filled this summer with people taking part in summer academy. And across Franklin and Hampshire counties, you do a lot of things, you'll see a lot of things in technology, you're working with kids in poverty, trauma, issues at home, etc. So we're trying to meet the needs that we've identified in our districts. We also do a lot of work in form. You'll see a handout that is about the LEAP initiative. That's Low Income Access Project. And we're part of where the state has given us a fair amount of funding to work with our district on a number of issues around how low income affects, how poverty affects the brain, how we can overcome that. Issues of trauma, issues of social emotional learning, and so we're prepared to provide that PD for member districts. You also, in your folder, have a little card that says Chicago Western Mass Schools. How many of you are familiar with that Facebook page? Well, good. So this Facebook page we developed prior to the vote in November around raising the charter school cap. It came from the request of our board, as well as our superintendents, to basically fit a particular need, namely that we have charter schools, private schools, and so on, that are able to really publicize the great things they do, and they draw kids from our districts. And so can we collectively have a place where people can see the great things that our public schools do, our non-charter public schools in Western Mass. It's full of stuff. I know all of you have some things on there. We always welcome more posts there. It's a really exciting place to look at all the great things that are going on in Western Mass. Another thing that we're doing. And we're also looking to open some possible new special education programs. We have members starting with our member school district to see maybe you have some out-of-district placements that you think you could pull back in, not go to the district and save money or transportation. So we're really looking for that opportunity as well. We're really kind of actively doing that at this point. So that's a really quick injury. Our website is full of other stuff. Please look at it. Do a lot of people all the time. Welcome your participation. I should mention that school committee members can come to our events as long as there's empty seats, just for the cost of the materials and meals. It's something we provide for our school committees to really help encourage you to know about the collaborative, also and professional development with us as well. As long as there's room, we welcome you to come just at the cost of the materials. Get rid of the materials. Do you have questions? Secondly, any ideas you might do to help serve you better? Any programs you'd like to see or services? I'll move over here in case. I'm sorry, I have my back.
You know, the collaborative does a wonderful job. I was fortunate enough to be involved for a year or maybe two, and I've got so much out of the collaborative, just as far as education as a school committee member. I was curious, have you put thought into what the funding sources are going to look like in the next year or two with the changes in administration out of Washington?
We definitely put a lot of thought into it. We fully expect grants and contracts from the federal government and local government will diminish, the state government. An example of that is we had a grant into the federal government, NEA, for an arts work grant, which basically is to help develop arts programming in our member districts. We just had notice today that they aren't making any awards. They're waiting to see what happens. And if it's going to happen, we're going to come to call. Right. But that's the first direct kind of information we've gotten from the courses. So we are looking at how can we diversify. There was education programs, looking at the possibility of providing some transportation that would be of use, so expanding our property purchasing. So I think there are a lot of areas we're going to look at that will expand what we do. And we are, of course, thinking about that all the time. Not just for us, but for you guys.
Right.
You can have less and less funding for professional development, especially. So collaborative hopefully can help all the districts meet those needs by being smart, efficient, and effective. So
yes.
Thank you for asking that.
Sure.
Yes.
Billy, you mentioned
these are my plans.
Yeah, exactly. I echo Trevor's comments. I go to a lot of meetings. But you, I think, if I remember correctly, you mentioned that over time the professional development enrollment has been dropping, that people aren't taking as many courses, and particularly the courses about becoming principals or superintendents.
Yeah.
There's been a decline. And I just wonder if you could comment on that for people, because we always need good leaders in these schools.
I think it's true statewide. There are fewer people in principal licensure programs. Superintendent licensure programs, I think they're really hard jobs. they really are very difficult. I think people who know that don't shy away from it. It's a real challenge. So, and our, some of our key educational positions, especially special education and ELL, also have more and more problems with teachers in those areas. So we have programs in those areas. You may know, in answer to your question, that we are strongly considering doing a big reduction for our member districts in those programs to help both fill our seats, but also provide more opportunities for your folks. Right now, for example, we have funding, federal funding, to support teachers who want to get a second license in special education to get a couple of courses for free, and we started in that role. So if you have some people in your district who are interested or you're thinking about getting some dual license, you need more flexibility, then we have an opportunity to start that process. So yeah, it is a thing.
So I'm Phil Cantor of Conway and Frontier. So I would just, if you, you're asking for suggestions, I would ask you the same as I would ask any other educational leader in this area, and that is to please become more politically active.
Yes, so I am currently meeting with all of our legislators in the area. I'm also really pushing forward on the rural schools initiative.
I know you are. That's awesome.
And we're about Carl is about to, on behalf of MicroEcon, leading it, launching a website for that, and we'll support the website and so on, get more visibility. But yeah, absolutely. I mean, we jointly have some huge issues wrestling with that we have to have united front, and we recognize the fact that our collaborative represents more rural districts than any other collaborative in the Commonwealth. So we're joining forces with the Cape Cod collaborative to really have more of a voice. And between the two of us in Mercer County, we probably have 80% of the rural districts in the state. So we have to play a role in that, absolutely. Thanks.
Are any members taking any classes right now? I am. Social emotional learning with
different landscapes.
I know, really. Very well, thank you. But I will say that it's not only convenient, because it's right in Northampton. It's very easy to find. The building's very nice. It's very clean. And you hire good people to teach.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
So far, so good.
So
thank you very much for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
for coming.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Good work.
A rainy night.
Any other public comment tonight? Hearing none, we'll be moving along. We have no unfinished business. So we are into new business, the presentation of professional development plan. It's really too bad. But you just lifted up the box. I probably
am
short enough.
I'll back up for this one.
Yes, at the risk of putting everyone to sleep, we're going to
Hey, well, we're really delighted to be here tonight to share with you what the impact of this, all of this professional development has been on students, not just on the educators. So I'll let my colleague begin with a little background.
Let's talk over each other a little bit. So as many of you may remember, if you were on the school committee a few years ago, in 2014-15, we did a study to look for a better model than the one that we had at the time. At Frontier, we had 6 half days. At the elementary school, we really only had 1 full day with a lot of pullout. Marty Barrett approached us and said, you know, we're spending a lot of money on subs as teachers are getting pulled out of the classroom. Students are losing time with their primary teacher. Let's do some exploration and see if there's something that's better out there that would work for the district. So we did some research as an administrative team. We visited other schools. We did surveys. Once we had decided on a model, which was the early release Friday model, we conducted focus groups with families and one about our merry way. Some of the research showed that for high-quality professional development, you really need to have something that is sustained. It's really focusing on teacher strategies. It provides teachers with time to collaborate after the professional development experience. And those were some things that were lacking in the model that we had before. We would do a half day, and then it would be a month and a half before we had another half day. So you spent an hour trying to catch up on what you had done on the first half day, and it used an awful lot of time that we didn't have. So we implemented the model in 2015-16. We planned 30 early release Fridays, and based on that experience, at the end of the 15-16 school year, we handed out more surveys, we collected information, and based on that information from staff and families, we reduced the number to 25, which is what we had this year. We reduced the number of PD topics so that we could deepen our focus a little bit. And then we decided to extend the themes from year one to year two. A lot of that was based on faculty feedback, wanting more continuity. We ended up with this calendar. I'm not going to go into detail here, but this is the 16-17 calendar. The orange represents technology. Yellow is differentiated instruction. The green for the Union Elementary Schools, it's the Hitchcock Center. And we really were trying to focus on those three particular areas. The other colors represent different focus group projects. We did the same thing at Frontier. We tried to unionize PK through 12 and work on similar themes. So again, differentiated instruction, technology. The green represents outside consultants, and blue is department. A couple of weeks ago, we had about 349 respondents from families. We also conducted a staff survey and administrative survey in order to collect information once again, like we did at the end of last year. One of the questions we asked, because we made the assumption going in that Fridays were going to be a better day for families because it would help to get them started on the weekend, it would be an easier day for them to deal with. We also had heard back from faculty that when we had half days on Friday, it was less disruptive to the continuity of the week for students. So to have it on a Tuesday or Thursday or Wednesday, which is sometimes when we did our half days, it just kind of made the week a little bit too jaggy. So our survey results from families showed that indeed 70% of families preferred Fridays, 20% didn't have a preference, and then 10% were divided between some of the other days. In general, families, it was a fairly similar results to what we had last year. About 70% of the students of those that were surveyed were going home on the early release Fridays. 32% were staying either at the elementary or Frontier to participate in activities. And about half and half thought that the early release model was a great idea, and half of the families, it was challenging for them to work into their schedule.
Okay. So what are we focused on when we're doing professional development? Well, the most important thing to us as educators is we're preparing our students for the world that they are in and the world they will be entering as college students, as adult workers. So the 21st century skills that educators focus on that come from what industry says they are looking for is collaboration, collaborate and work in teams. Is there creativity? because the old factory model, those jobs are gone. They are in India and Pakistan and other places. So our kids need to be creative, have imagination, critical thinking, and communication. Those are what are considered the 21st century skills among educators. So we've collected information from observations. As an administrative team, all of our principals and Sarah and myself and our assistant principals go out into classrooms and we actually track data digitally on what we're seeing. One of the things we look for is student collaboration on projects, because that's an important skill. From September to March, we saw an enormous increase this year. We've really focused on this in the professional development through our work with Mike Anderson, who talks about differentiation. So those, and this comes from 290 classroom visits across the district among all of the administrators doing classroom visits. Critical thinking. We were pretty good in 2013-14. We analyzed according to a checklist that we have about what critical thinking looks like, but it's gone up to 84%. That's very high, and we're quite pleased with that, that we're looking at the content of what students are doing, and is it asking them to just do memorization, or are they really having to think to solve problems? So this we're quite pleased with. Communication. What that's looking at is students communicating ideas with one another, not the teacher talking at the class. So we track how much teacher talk and how much student talk is happening when we're in the classrooms. That has gone way up in the last 3 years of students actually communicating thoughts to one another. Creativity and imagination, we're going to show you we have qualitative data, not quantitative data, meaning it's what you're about to see in our slides. So here are the consultants that we worked with over the last 2 years. Mike Anderson, up on the your left, is an international presenter on differentiation through student choice. He's come back several times and worked very closely with our faculty on how to make learning more individualized for students' own readiness for those particular concepts. Hitchcock Center, the one in the middle, Hitchcock Center for the Environment, some of you may be familiar with them. They are environmental educators who worked extensively both, we introduced it last year. This summer, several teachers came in the summer for more training with the Hitchcock Center, and they've come repeatedly throughout the year. The big focus this year was engineering design, an area that elementary teachers often don't have a big background in, but is a huge focus of the new science standards.
So Mike Anderson came PK through 12. Hitchcock Center focused on the elementary level. Marcy Abramson on the upper right is a math specialist, and she's come in and worked with our middle school teachers to really emphasize hands-on learning and helping students really understand math in a different way. She's done both coaching at the middle school level, and she did workshops in the afternoon, so she came for a full day and really worked with our teachers. On the bottom right, Gary Chadwell, we've been working with him for years. He teaches the John Collins writing method, which our school adopted about 7 or 8 years ago. But this year he came to work with the English and Social Studies department in order to help them collaborate around common expectations in writing. And so they've made a lot of progress. On the lower left is Sapphire Dujong. She's actually from the collaborative, and she has not quite visited us yet. We had to postpone her due to snow once. I think we had to jiggle a couple of times, actually, because of all the snow days that we had.
So teacher collaboration, also embedded in our professional development calendar, is time for our teachers to both work together across the district and within their own schools. So how does that impact student learning?
So we have some evidence, and the rest of the slideshow is going to be mostly pictures of what's happening in the classrooms, which is really the fun part, because this is what we all love to do and feel like we want to spend most of our time doing, although other things pull us away. This picture is of a social studies classroom. Actually, the teacher, Allison Walters, is sitting in the back, and the students are engaged in a student debate. They have water filtration experiments that happen up in the science department, and they've used collaboration time to refine those particular strategies and help make things more, they work on labs together in the science department.
And here's a picture just showing, in the elementary level, there are times that are built in that are school-based, and on the left is an example of a school-based training that happened about 2 or 3 weeks ago on social skills curriculum with teachers training teachers. This is an example of there are times we can get all of the teachers of a particular grade from across the district to get together to collaborate about curriculum. So both types of collaboration happen.
This is the result of a technology workshop that happened in the science department, got together. Kahoot is a quiz type software program, and here's the students using that program in their class. The topics in algebra course was redesigned this year, and the math department used their collaboration time in order to redesign it. These particular students are working on profit and loss calculations. Again, water clarity. Science department collaborated on some of these labs and also introduced the idea of how to put choice into these labs. So not only were they collaborating about particular learning activities, but they were collaborating around how to design good choices based on the Mike Anderson work. Again, this is a math department collaboration, Marcy Abramson and the hands-on learning that the students are involved in. And this was a technology collaboration up in science where students were using software to balance chemical equations. They asked me to explain the details, but they were pretty good at it. We had Pi Day. Pi Day is 314 for those of you who don't know. We actually had a snow day on Pi Day, and so the math department had designed an entire day of math learning, which is unusual. I mean, it's really easy to come up with days that are around English and social studies. It's really hard to come up with a day around math, but they managed to do it. It was very engaging and a lot of fun, and they had pie.
So differentiated instruction through choice. This is the work that we've done extensively with Mike Anderson, and this is just an example of a second grade and how students now have the choice. We're all learning about money. Some of you might want to do it in a game. Some of you might want to do it counting and filling out equations. So to give students, it's not a choice to learn about money, but you have a choice about how you're going to learn it. And so what we've learned from Mike Anderson is this process of choose, do, review. And the beauty is it's happening from preschool up through the high school now, is setting kids up, teachers plan meaningful choices, engaging choices, the students get to choose and do the choices, and then they come back, and here's the really critical part. They review their work and they reflect on their own growth. What on their own learning? What are the benefits of choice? Well, students are learning to become effective decision makers, critical to the democracy that we live in. They own their work more authentically. If I get to choose what I do, I'm more invested. So there's more motivation for learning. And what Mike Anderson says is, if we want students to develop the skills of creative thinking, innovation, persistence, and flexible thinking, we'd better start giving them chances to have more control over their own learning. This is a big shift for us. So what is this? How does this impact students? Well, on the left is an example of preschool. In preschool, students are now being asked, decide what you want to do, look over the choices, write your name on a piece of paper, so they're practicing their name writing. Draw a plan for what you're going to play with today. Give it to the teacher, then you get to play. So it's asking kids to think carefully before they dive in. This is a first grade example, meta choice, meaning metacognition about your own choice. Why you chose what you chose for math today? Because. Why? Was it a good choice for you, and why? So beginning in first grade, reflecting on your own learning and your own process. This is a second grade example. What went well with your research project? What do you wish went better? And what will you do differently? Again, skills that we didn't used to teach. It used to be you got an A, right? You got an A, you got a B.
So here's an example of students choosing in an eighth grade English class. They got to choose the groups. They chose their role in the group, and then they also chose the topic that they were going to be working on. In a science class, students chose the context that they were going to do their pre-learning with. So they either watched a video, they read an article, and then they came together as a group and worked on their project together. This is a third grade example where students were conducting research on plants as part of their science, but they got to decide, do you want to work in a group, do you want to work independently, or do you want to work with one partner? So this is, they got to choose that. And also, would you rather read a book, or would you rather do it, conduct your investigation online?
In an English class, they were chose from four different project scenarios, and then they worked through that project scenario, and then they shared with each other if they worked on a different project scenario.
In math, besides choosing what materials will best help you learn, students now are being given choices about where do you want to learn? Do you want to do it at your desk, or are you a person who's more comfortable working on the floor? And again, that didn't used to be common. Now we're seeing that kids are making good choices about where they want to work, and then they're asked to reflect, was that a good choice for you?
Here's another English class where they chose their topic and their role. A lot of these choices sound very simplistic, but it really, if you think about your own learning and your own opportunities, having some control over your day really makes a big difference. And that was something that we did some of, but we didn't recognize the importance of prior to these workshops.
Even seating. Classrooms are beginning to look different after our work with Mike Anderson. Learning about the fact that not everybody wants to sit at a table to learn. Sometimes you want to lounge in a chair. Sometimes you want to sit in a small group. We now have kids sitting on floors. Teachers have made different kinds of seating. And they're even standing desks because some kids just don't sit well. Well, now they get to choose, where am I going to learn today? Here's another example from a second grade. Okay, impact on student learning, subject specific. So we're going to focus a little bit on, show you some examples of how students have benefited from our work focused on science and math. So what does the teacher training look like? Well, the teachers are actually involved in the kinds of projects that their students will be doing. So the teachers get in and do the engineering design before they're going to go and try it with their students. What is engineering design? Well, it's imagining, planning, creating, and then this reflecting on what did not work, because most of the things that kids are designing now do not work the first time. And that's a good thing, because they get to reflect and improve. So here's an example. It usually starts with a real problem or question. Kindergarten, how can we help birds in the winter? Well, kids looked out and said, hey, maybe we can make some bird feeders. So what we used to do is we'd bring in all the bird seed and the peanut butter, and everybody would make the same bird feeder. Well, what we're learning to do now, kids conducted research. This is actually an iPad about different kinds of bird feeders. Then they made a plan for what their bird feeder was going to look like, and they chose the materials. So this little girl decided she wanted to make a bird feeder out of a hollowed out pumpkin. Then they hung them up and actually observed how they work. Here's another second grade example. If you were stranded on a desert island and only had these materials, and they all got their mystery materials, how would you protect your head and upper body from the sun? So the kids designed, out of the materials given, solar protection devices. And this was on a project of properties of matter and learning how different matter interacts with water and light. How can you design roofs of buildings to collect rainwater?
Something that would be good today. Yeah.
We need that. Yeah, roofs. Roofs. Can you use magnets to create art? And then after that challenge, using the actual magnets, then students wrote a how-to. And no two were exactly the same. They used cotton balls and paint, and they had to write out their steps. Rube Goldberg, if any of you have seen the devices, can you design a structure to ring a bell with a ball in 5 steps? Kids loved this. So here they all are. This was a really successful one. Knock the ball, all that goes down, and ding, it rang the bell. And this was in fourth grade.
Can you build a beaver dam to hold water? And this is actually this week. And students, first, they had to budget. They had to buy their materials. And they were given a budget of $50. And each material cost a certain amount, so it was integrating math. And then they built it. First time, total disaster, because the teacher pours the water in, and it has to hold enough to make a skating pond. And none of them held. So then they had to go back to the drawing board and think about, what other materials will I use tomorrow? So they did a rebuild, and the teacher wrote to me today and said, we've learned to really respect beavers, because none of them held this time either, but the students were very excited about trying to redesign and use what they learned the first time.
We've done a lot with, I told you before, with math workshops with Marcy Abraham. Here are two boys making a geometric figure.
Kindergarten, they got together and they decided that they were going to challenge kids with all of these materials. You design a ramp that will make these, the head, the balls go. And this team decided, you know what? Can we make one that will make the ball turn a corner?
This is a picture of the English and Social Studies department working together with Gary on a Friday afternoon. It was actually our last Friday afternoon, and it was a culminating event for them.
Art and science. This year, because we've had the science folks from Hitchcock come in several times, we've invited in our art music PE teachers to participate and think about the connections to science. So we've had a great integration. The art teachers decided to do a year-long study of Audubon and the birds, and these are, I think, third grade pictures, illustrations, third or fourth, of different birds. Also thinking about redesign based on feedback of observation of natural objects. So this is a study in looking at flowers and first draft, second draft, third draft, fourth draft, fifth draft, based on getting feedback from peers to make it look closer to what a lily actually looks like. And this is a first grade illustration, because students are being given multiple opportunities to get feedback, and just like the engineering design, improve their design. This is a collaboration that the students were studying about the science of the birds in fourth grade, and then in art class, spent a few weeks really coming up with the illustration that was accurate, scientifically accurate.
Not as exciting as art, but math. students are learning how to determine linear equations, and again, these are hands-on activities where students can work out and problem solve using real materials, tape, and really calculating from the bottom up as opposed to just being taught the formula. Another math, couple of boys doing a similar activity. And based on what we're seeing, as you can tell, we're really excited. The science things that are going on in elementary are really fun to watch. We're equally as excited at Frontier about some of the math workshops that we're seeing, the collaboration between English and social studies, the science, the collaboration that's going on across the building. Based on what we've seen, based on the surveys, what we're recommending is that we continue the early release model. We continue with 25 days. Some of the adjustments we'd like to make for next year is provide topics over several Fridays in a row, and I think you can see from the sketched out PD calendar for next year, we've tried to clump things together a little bit more because that is feedback that we got from faculty, and continue to concentrate the days in the fall and the winter, so that gives teachers an opportunity to really try things out. We've seen big changes in the information and what's going on in the classrooms throughout the course of the year. Which is exciting to see. So this is next year's calendar. You have a hard copy in front of you. And we did try to coordinate our color coding again. That's the end.
So, we'll wake you up.
Oh. Careful. Sorry.
May I add one thing?
Sure.
I think I'd like to just add one more thing about the the student choice. We are part of Massachusetts. We test really well as a state. We are part of MCAS 2. The things on MCAS 2 that the students are asked to perform, it's not rote learning. They're asked to perform high-level critical thinking, problem solving, articulation of what they're doing and starting over, analyzing whether it works or not. These students are being trained in the exact skills that are being valued by not only MCAS 2 testing, but are being valued by schools, high schools, colleges. It's really about critical thinking. It's about using your head. Because we live in an information society, the information is there. They saw the picture of the birdhouse, but they had to recreate it and analyze, is that the one I want? Are these the, is this the goal that I'm looking for? Are these the attributes? What will work best for me? And then problem solve their way through it. The same way we ask our kids to problem solve their way through personal problems with other students if they, you know, they have a little issue. But really and truly, this is the kind of learning. It's not just letting kids come for a free-for-all. It's having them think, consider, really, really critically look at, did it work and did it not work? What can I do to make it better? And then reflect. And we're asking everyone to be reflectors, reflecting on their practice. You're asking me to reflect on my practice, which I've done. So what we're asking these kids to do is really right up where they need to be. This is elevating education.
Does anyone have any questions? Bob? I do.
We have a lot of snow days, so they didn't get that many Fridays to do the program.
We lost a few. We lost four.
So you got 21, you finally get 21 in?
We got 21 in, yeah. It was bumpy, I have to admit. I mean, we had to reschedule a lot of things. It kind of lost that continuity the last couple of months because you get a blip, you get a snow day, you'd lose one, you'd have to pick up a project.
When we get to the discussion on the calendar, then that's where we'll talk about the impact snow days are going to have and what are we going to do and why I was in a position this year to either call them off, add them on, say yes, say no, maybe, because we just didn't have a definitive plan. So when we get to that point, we can talk about that.
I didn't know if possibly going forward, if maybe on the day of snow, maybe they could remotely go into a teaching thing where the teachers could take it remotely.
Well,
it's like sort of a workshop.
Yeah, one of the examples is we've had Mike Anderson, who lives in New Hampshire, scheduled to meet and do peer coaching with teachers on the Friday 2 weeks ago, I believe. And it was snowing. He was here the day before, and he said, I want to go home because it was about to hit. So some of it is we work around presenters. Some of it is, like, we had grade-level meetings once that were canceled, and, in fact, I'm going to look into maybe even having to pull teachers because we missed that meeting and it was really crucial. So some of it is like getting the people together.
And we actually only had one snow day on a Friday. It was mostly the days that were canceled because it was a Tuesday or something.
Right. And we understand that's challenging too for families too.
Nice presentation.
Yes,
yeah,
very good. Very good presentation.
Thank you.
More questions?
So I really appreciate the presentation and all the information. It was really helpful to see the real impact that this is happening, and it's great to see that it's so positive, and it's obviously a lot of work. So kudos to the guys for that. I do continue to worry that it's still very adult-centric and not very student-centric, and it creates a very chaotic, if you're a parent right now in any of the schools, a very chaotic structure for the kids, especially this year with all the snow days where we didn't know if we were having, we didn't know. And the Fridays mornings are very compressed and limited. And I just worry that how we can balance all the great positive impact that's happening for the teachers and ultimately for the classrooms with, you know, some of the perception that this isn't really, that the students are losing out in a way, which they're benefiting, but they also are losing half a day of structure in their week. They're, you know, sort of free play at the schools or going home or whatever, which is really important to kids to have a full day, full school day, full week of school. And, you know, and I think people looking at the district from outside don't really, or even people that don't have kids in school don't know what the benefits are from this. And they see a lot of kids roaming around Deerfield. Why are all these kids out here? And, you know, what is the school doing? So we need to make sure we're really getting the word out about what the positive is.
We absolutely agree. One of the things we used to do is we used to have 7 half days. See, right now the kids leave at 1:30. They used to leave at noon. There were 7 of those. So it wasn't that we had 0 time that kids.
Right.
And every time we wanted to do professional development, we hired subs. And so I used to have 7 grade level meetings a year, half a day. So 7 times 3 hours, kids were getting subs. So this was our desire to minimize that and to maximize the amount of time that we could get real professional development. Because out of those 7 days, 6 of them were parent conferences. So I had 1 half day a year to offer professional development for teachers. Anybody who's an educator knows that's not really valuable. And so we understand and we recognize we need to do a better job of communicating to the community that there really are shifts happening because we have this continuity for the professional development of the teachers. And it really is, it sounds like half day, but it's really an hour and a half. It's not, we used to get out at noon.
But it has lunch and it has recess. And
but we have that every day also.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you can, you know, that presentation, if it can be loaded on Frontier's Facebook page, if it could be, you know, so the parents can, you know, I'll go home and, you know, I'll have questions of, you know,
well, it's already
is this working? Oh, perfect. Yeah. So if we can, you know, the more we can educate the public about it, the parents, that was a great presentation. I love the work you're doing with Mike Anderson. And, it was lacking when I went here, and it's so nice to see the kids having that ability to figure out where they want to sit and do their work instead of constant rigid stuff. It was one of the reasons I didn't finish school here. I needed that different kind of education, and it's so great to see it here at Frontier now and in our whole district. So
thank you, and yeah, we welcome suggestions on how we can communicate. You know, this was just our 2nd year, and our 1st year we got it up and running, and we really are in a groove now where we, you know, understand the balance between bringing outside people in, doing inside internal conversations. But we welcome ideas on getting the word out.
Judy? Yes.
2 things. 1, I so appreciate the simplified year 3 plan. Like I remember the 1st year, and I was like, what? Even you guys were like, what is going on? So this is really good. It makes a lot of sense to me, and it's very clear, even as a non-educator, what this is, what's happening in the space at the time. You said that what you referenced the cost savings, the implied cost savings of moving to this model, and I don't know if there's any data yet on what those actually ended up being.
Yeah,
that you could share with us.
We already did it last year. Unfortunately, we don't have it for this year, but we could look into it. We'd probably be comparing now back to the 14-15 school year.
We used to hire subs to meet with
for sub coverage. So we can certainly try to get those numbers. We'll consult with Patty about the best way to do that. We did do it last year, and there was some savings last year, particularly in the fall months. That seemed to be the time.
And something to note, that one thing Bill Deal said about grant funding, all of our presenters are paid for by grants that are now at serious risk. We just got a notice from MASS that Title IIA, which is the grants we use to pay these presenters, doesn't come out of local funds, are about to be, well, the federal government wants to cut them to zero. To zero.
But a terrific zero.
Sorry?
That zero is terrific. It's a terrific zero.
Yeah, and actually redirect the funds to charter schools. That's the current head of the federal government education department is a fan of charter schools. So she would like to redirect the funds that we've used for professional development in public schools to charter schools. And that's the reality we're facing right now. So. Were we, you know, to go ahead next year, we would, if we get zero funding, we'll use it as collaboration time among our own educators. But it is a challenge we're facing. Yes.
That's the true benefit of intrinsic motivation, right? I mean, if we are going to grow intrinsic motivation, it's a really good point that a lot of people in the community don't know what's happening. We need to grow it at all of the schools. So even the teachers can help communicate what's going on. I mean, I'm the parent of two teenage daughters who tell me everything going on. I know what's going on.
Well, yeah, they all share.
But they share.
Yeah, they're telling you everything. You just keep it in and out. Doug, do you have I'm a teenage daughter.
Related to all the those kind of notes, that I mean, I've heard in a couple cases like the perception that you know, the school year, the school time for students has been reduced because of this, and so I think that's another thing to communication wise, to you know, proactively address to the extent.
Yeah, no, I think you're all right. I mean, you're all hitting on the same thing about you know getting some more.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Just, I'm sorry to interrupt. May I speak?
You may speak.
Thank you. Did you, or because I had some concerns, and I asked them to cut it down. It was 30, and then this year it went to 26, and now it's 25. But didn't you take the amount of?
We did calculate
what was the number
the time.
Of days.
So it was 2.7% of time for the elementary. It was 3.3% of time for the high school relative to all the hours of the school year. So when you actually do the math calculations on it, it's not that large a percentage of time that students are not in classes. It's lower for the elementary because they've got the parent-teacher conferences.
Keith?
I would agree with Doug and Judy. I think it would be important as part of that slideshow to have some quantitative data about. I think the previous model, a lot of that missed time was really hidden. About half a year, half a year in there. Mm-hmm. Now it seems like it's an hour and a half, but how much time did the students miss in the old model compared to the new model? How much funding did we save by the new model? I think statistically, as part of that slideshow, we'll be doing that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Did you want to
one more?
Piggyback on that is the 50% of families that are not happy where this mm-hmm. is challenging for, that's a pretty big number, 50%
of the respondents.
Of the respondents, you know, and I think we need to pay attention to that.
Sure. I would actually, we never asked under the old model when we had 7 half-days how happy
families were. Right, so you don't know what the benchmark
was. To have their children released 7 times at noon either. Right. So I agree, but I also wonder, we don't have those data. Right. You know, how happy were you 7 half-days? So, yeah. Other?
Judy?
I also wonder how, like that satisfaction number, that 50% unhappy and 50% happy, how much of that is younger grades versus older grades. As a parent of an older kid, I can tell you I use that Friday afternoon to plan appointments. That's when I know I'm not pulling them out of class and I'm taking them someplace mm-hmm. else, doctor, dentist, whatever. Mm-hmm. So, and I was worried about it at the beginning, worried about my kid roaming around Deerfield and just doing random things, but it sort of leveled out.
Leveled out. We only do random things certain days.
A little roaming is not a bad thing, though, either.
You're right. The other thing we tried to accommodate families is when it was 7 half-days, families paid for childcare 7 times. And we have a non-cost option for families now if they need their child to stay. So we did try to take into consideration how can we support families around this and make it as easy as possible.
Okay. Bob, and then Trevor. Bob first.
Question I have, in the rank and file faculty, are they happy with this or would they rather be back than 7 half-days?
Okay, we did a survey. We did an online survey of what we asked, what did you gain from the professional development? And it was a very high response to what they gained. We didn't say, do you want to go back? But what are the challenges? So teachers did name some of the challenges of, you know, fitting everything in. But at the same time, their response was it was more beneficial. It really paid off. I don't like being pulled out of class so much for meetings. So we did survey the faculty too.
But it is a lot of work. I mean, this is a model that takes a lot more work than the old model, because the old model, you could show up, listen to a presentation, and you know, you were kind of done for a while. This model, teachers are having to come back to the table over it's a lot of work.
Is every single faculty member thrilled that we're asking them to work harder, more, and do more collaboration?
No.
Especially on Friday afternoon.
On a Friday afternoon. But they've risen to the challenge, and the payoff is with the kids. Yeah.
Trevor, wait.
I already asked one. Go ahead.
It's actually up to the chair, just so you know.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But if you would like to defer, that's okay.
I will defer.
We just need to keep this moving.
Gotcha.
Sir?
Well, I think you got to get that message out to the public as well. That the teachers are really working hard on a Friday afternoon, because there is that perception out there that, well, it's a great Friday for these teachers. And,
yeah.
You know, somebody said to me, I don't know who it was, that attendance is better on Friday now for teachers. And I don't know what that meant, but I think that's the other part of the message you need to get out, that, you know, this isn't all fun and games.
These are professional
teachers.
People.
It's hard
Thanks.
Work.
Thanks, John.
Just real quickly, how the IAs play in? I know that was a concern in the first year and kind of worked through the second year, and if we, I don't know where that was at, so.
Well, the instructional assistants are contracted through that time, so some of them are using, they're rotating through doing the child care, support with the child care.
Yep.
And then at the elementary level.
Yep.
And when they're not responsible for that, they get to participate in the professional development along with teachers.
Nice.
So that's beneficial for them professionally and
right.
to supporting our students and our learning.
Right.
So it's a sort of rotate through depending on the school.
On what's available.
Yeah.
Other
and we are
priorities.
Looking at that more too.
Okay.
See if we can provide more opportunities.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work to set these up and organize them for teachers.
And so it's mainly teachers, yeah. And then you can,
and so we kind of pull the IAs into some of those
where you
PD
can.
Experiences, but we are looking at the full day in particular to do workshops specifically for them so
right.
they feel like they're getting
So this out. Year when we were planning, when we were coming together to plan, one of my questions was, we do not have school, the students do not come to school on voting day. Mm-hmm. I asked if we could have four sessions of 1.5 hour, 90-minute trainings for the paras on that day, because the paras on voting day will not be responsible for children. So we plan on getting four really solid trainings in for the IAs on that day, and then
right.
they rotate throughout the year. So the goal is that they would have 6 or 7, you know, solid trainings during the school year.
Okay, thank you.
The collaboratives maybe provide some of that training for them on those days? I mean, just look at the stuff they do, like social emotional learning.
Yeah, actually, we did this past November, the collaborative had a training specifically for instructional assistants, and some of our instructional assistants were offered that option to choose that. And we also did offer IA-specific trainings in the fall that were, some of them were our teachers offering them, or specialists offering them to train the instructional assistants. And we're having them coming up our parent-teacher conference days. So some of our reading specialists are offering trainings in literacy to instructional assistants during that time.
Right.
Keith?
If I had questions or recommendations about the development calendar, would that be better served during the calendar discussion?
Probably.
Speaking of which.
Okay. Thank you
thank
very
you.
Much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good
job. Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you. It was great. Okay.
So we can move on to
reviewing Frontier Regional and School Union 38 calendars. I believe we have to vote on these separately, so I'm going to take firsties because I'm like that. So we'll go to Frontier on the Frontier School District calendar. So discussion. I actually do have a motion to accept. Do I have a motion?
You have a motion.
Motion by Judy. Do I have a second? Bob just seconded it. So then you guys can do that, and then we can have an open discussion.
Can we have a motion on the 38 calendar?
Okay, now discussion. So if we could take Frontier first. Yeah.
I think when we decided to do this program, just explained to everybody, it had some sort of a sunset thing. I think we want to allow it to continue and not let it sunset.
Oh, I don't remember that.
I that was part of the discussion when we originally passed it. There was considerable dissension from some of the faculty. I'm getting old, I don't remember. But, you know, I thought there was some dissension, and we talked about, you know, doing it on a trial basis.
I'm just looking
instead
for the year
before. But I just wanted to say we should continue the program.
Yeah.
So I'll move it.
Would you like to lay the calendars out?
Does anyone have any questions on the calendar? Because
yeah.
I think we can all read. Bob? Bill, ooh, sorry, Bill.
My question is about September 1st.
September 1st.
How in the world do we end up with a four-day weekend after we've been in school for 2 days?
Why are we doing
it? You want to tell me the atmosphere for learning is better on June 19th than it is on September 1st?
When do we start? The 29th?
Look at the kids. You have Friday and Monday off, Labor Day weekend. You've been in school for 2 days and you got the day off.
The Monday is new teacher day on the 28th. The 29th is the teacher's first day they work without the students. The students come in for Wednesday and Thursday, and then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday is
a four-day weekend.
I don't understand.
The question's really, where did the Friday come from, right?
Yeah.
Is that a new thing?
Raise your hands, please. But I think Marty started that last year or the year before. I'm not 100% sure.
I don't care if Moses started it.
Okay.
Explain to me the logic. Okay. You teach in school on 19th of June rather than the 1st of September. I don't understand it. When it's 100 degrees outside in June, nothing is going to happen in that classroom in June. But you're going to be off for a 4-day weekend on Labor Day after you just had 2 months of vacation. I'm not the brightest bulb in the circuit, but I'm missing something. I would prefer to go to school on Friday.
Darius, do you want to take this? Would you like to interject here?
Sure.
I think we already complimented
We did the long weekend, I think it came out 1 year when Labor Day was earlier or later. I forget how it worked out, but it was a lot of families liked it, especially if we heard feedbacks from the younger elementary kids that the entry level of a long first week kind of going into it, and that was you're saying 2 days. Administratively, you know, we're here from mid-August moving on, so but that long weekend, a lot of we got a lot of feedback that people liked it, so it's one of those things that's, you know, educationally you can, you know, put the day there, you can
lose learning time.
Well, they're not losing learning time.
We're going to teach it September 1st. We're going to try to teach it on the 18th of June.
Okay, so full disclosure, I come from a school system that has that Friday off. We have for forever. And we do that. We come in on Monday, or new teachers come in the Friday before. We come in on Monday. The kids, the ninth graders come in on Tuesday. And then we have Wednesday and Thursday to kind of get all that paperwork out. Hi, how are you? Get the books out. Everybody's real cool. Everybody's visiting. And then we have that 4-day weekend, and then we hit the ground running. And it really is a lot better from my perspective. Bob?
Well, just to let you know how many negotiation teams I was on before we got the teachers to negotiate with us to start before Labor Day, because a lot of other school systems do start before Labor Day, and I can't remember how many years ago it was when we finally agreed on it to start and to try to get out early. I mean, it was probably two negotiations ago, which is probably 5 or 6 years ago when we finally got it. Because I've been on the school board a long time, and we fought every year to start before Labor Day, and it was always those certain teachers, not to pick on the teachers, but they had the place down the Cape, and they got it. They had to have their Labor Day weekend. And that was the big battle until we finally got it. We came to a compromise and started now before Labor Day.
Anyone else?
I just want to offer the counter to, again, a week where there's 2 days that a working family has to get the kids to school, but then 3 days where they don't, and that, you know, you can take the whole week off, or you take just a few days off. It just is more challenging for those families that don't have that week off already, or if they're not a teacher, or if they're not, you know, working in the district.
Anyone else?
So, I'm trying to remember, because I was on the school committee went through, you know, during when it changed from starting after to starting before, and I know there was the rationale about that easing into things for the kids in the elementary particularly. Is there more than that's going, you know, because the other side of it is, you know, Labor Day is that classic marker of the end of the summer, and a lot of, you know, families are still thinking about, you know,
vacations and other things that involve that Labor Day weekend and doing that with family, and a lot of times, you know, doing it over a week. And the schedule, you know, prevents that. And so I don't know if there's been surveys since we've been doing this of the families or not.
There has not been surveys that I know of.
And is there other reason that we're doing it? I mean, the only feedback, and it's not been a lot, but has been negative. If I were giving feedback as a parent, mine would probably be on the negative side. So I'm just curious what the educational reasoning for doing it, or if it is it that.
Bill?
I think what brought it about, finally, is when we ended up with two different calendars 4 or 5 years ago. The union adopted one calendar, the reason adopted something different, and that made everybody crazy.
Fair enough.
We were starting on different dates. So that's what we moved to the other, finally moved to the other side of Labor Day. And that's what we've delivered for probably right about 4 or 5 years.
Well, I grant you consistency across it is desirable, but why did one even, what initially precipitated we should start before Labor Day?
So we don't go to school until July?
In a moment.
Wait a minute, one person at a time.
First, if you do this down, you know, if you wait till after Labor Day, now you're into 8th and 9th of September before you start. If it's the first, that's fine. But the first Monday moves all over the first week in September, and it really races out with the calendar. So if you say you're going to start on the 30th of August or the 29th of August, it doesn't matter when Labor Day is.
Yeah.
Because you're going to take it off anyway.
Don?
Just to follow up on that, I think when it really came to fruition was when we went for a year when we had a lot of snow days, and we went to June 29th. And everybody was saying, what the hell are we doing here?
Yeah, yeah.
That's when the teachers finally caved in and said, hey, you know what? I don't want to be here June 29th. I'm starting poorly. That's the reality of it.
Yeah. So I think
I don't get this Friday. That doesn't make sense to me either, Bill. I don't know where that comes from.
Yes, and I think the question that's being raised here is a 4-day weekend necessary at the end
that's
of
what
the
I,
week before Labor Day?
I don't think it is.
The national holiday is the Monday. It's not a 4-day weekend. So the question becomes, do we want to consider as a joint committee, perhaps modifying the recommended calendar? Let me ask the question. I don't know if that's what you're asking, but are you asking, should we take that Friday, make it a school day, and not go the Monday the 18th? I mean, that to me is a little crazy as well,
yes.
That you're coming in one day at the end of the school year on a Monday.
You're gonna have snow.
Irregardless of snow days.
Well, that changes the whole thing.
You're right, Ken. The holiday is on Monday, and everybody has it off. It's a national holiday.
Right.
Not all parents have Friday off. Very few do. And we're talking about hardships for childcare. Okay, we're taking Friday off. If you don't have a vacation plan, then what are you gonna do? You gotta find a place, childcare services for Friday, because we decided we'd have a 4-day weekend.
Elaine, and then Bob.
I actually don't agree with you. I mean, I think it is the end of the summer. A lot of people maximize their travel time mm-hmm. on that weekend before they get into the grind of the school year. So I actually think this is a more, many school districts are doing this, and it does make sense to, if you're eking out some days to start before Labor Day, you know, to just get the calendar going so you don't go to school until July. You know, so then throwing in the Friday on top of it, just, I don't know, you're gaining a day, and is it really, I don't know, it doesn't make that much sense to me.
And I remember back when this originally came, the immediate feedback was having the 2 days, as Cindy outlined, where you get all of the paperwork out of the way and you get the start to, you know, a lot of the, you know, the regular routines aren't established yet, but you're able to get the paperwork out of the way, you're able to get the kids established, you're able to get things started, and you've got a little bit of a break, and then you hit the ground running, finally on the school year on Tuesday after Labor Day. And I, you know, we fought, as
numerous people here have said, we fought so long to be able to start before Labor Day that it makes sense to have that short week. I don't know what the answer is on the Friday. It's just a question because, from in my mind, because it's just the national holiday is Monday. It's not a typical four-day
it's
week.
It's still summer.
It is still summer. I don't deny that.
So we're going to live in summer.
I would think that a lot of parents are going to keep their kids home those 2 days rather than come back from the cake. See if they've got a place to cake. They're going.
Did you say most?
Most
parents aren't in the cake.
That's right.
What's the
point? Are you serious, Bob? How many people are we talking about?
We're inconveniencing with this cake.
A lot of people.
Boys.
Don't want to come home. Just start school for 2 days.
It's already 7:20.
Boys. Okay. Yes, yeah. Let's move along. Does anyone have anything different to offer to the conversation, Keith?
Just to think about for next year, the snow days and the early release of professional development, a couple of options I would ask to consider possibly eliminating the professional development maybe in January and February, or having blank spots open in March to accommodate for the snow days. So if there are snow days, everything just can get bumped back, and that way there's no cancellation or no movement. But I think that the question about, and it has been brought to me about, what's the value if it's so easily canceled? So I have a hard time answering that question.
The superintendent can speak to.
Thanks, Keith. I was, after the first discussion, I was going to bring that up. So really, the reason why we had to decide each time whether we were going to cancel or not was because last year there was a policy in place. The teachers were all aware of it, the administration, that if there was a cancellation during the week, we would, you know, cancel early release. If there was a late arrival, or what we call delayed arrival, then we may or may not. So each time we ran into, and we had quite a few snow days this year, it was a discussion, should we or shouldn't we, what's happening. More often than not, it happened to be just the teachers collaborating, not just, but more internal. So canceling that was a little more easy. At one point we did cancel a day, and I think the high school had 3 or 4 speakers. We were able to send Mike Anderson back, but it was very confusing. So I've decided this year, with the help of this committee, tell me what it is we need to do, and then we will do it every single time. I would say we don't cancel it. Regardless of snow days or late arrivals or anything, we just don't cancel it. It's an hour and a half. We just go with the regular schedule. So parents know after tonight that these days will be the days, regardless, that the kids will go home early. Because parents were wondering, I was, making the phone calls. I worked really hard this year to call families the night before, whenever we had an event, a weather event, so that the children even knew before they went to bed, tomorrow it's a 2-hour delay, or tomorrow there's no school, so that even they were settled when they got up. When the students know the night before there's a 2-hour delay, they're much more calm coming in than if I call them at 6 o'clock in the morning, bounce them out of bed and say, oh, 2-hour delay, and then they come to school and it's all a big change in their routine. The problem that I had this year was, do I or don't I cancel? There was a policy. There was a kind of give and take policy. I would like a solid policy, and I would like you to help me develop that policy. Should we do it every week regardless? Should we not? But I think the bigger question right now on the table is the Friday before Labor Day. I'd like to solve that and then look at what we should do. So while you're thinking about Friday, please think about what you want me to do on the early release days if there's a weather event.
Well, we can bring that up in the calendar.
Wait a minute. You don't really have a say.
We need a clear policy that is followed every time. I'm not sure why the policy changed from the first year to this year. I mean, it was pretty clear the first year what happened when there was a snow day. It just got canceled. And I guess I don't like the back and forth nature of it all. It's very difficult.
The way it was you know, communicated to me was that, you know.
Well, it was never communicated the change.
It ended up being a cost thing. It happened under Marty as well, and the fact that we had some very expensive presenters coming on a particular Friday, we're like, if you cancel that on that Friday, we're not going to be able to reschedule them, and we already paid for them, that kind of thing. So that's how we started breaking the system.
But then canceling them all this year.
And then that's what happened. And then it turned into when the Linda first day, you got to make a decision. She was like, no. And then this is what we, you know, based on what we have. And so we agree that we'd like to see consistency too. So we know, because the teachers need to know right away what are they planning on and that kind of stuff. So we agree, but that's how it happened. It fell apart.
And I
liked Pete's
suggestion of building in extra days, at least using some of the days as contingency, because
before you do the
Bob?
Clarification. Who made the motion to begin with?
Judy.
Judy, would you accept an amendment to go to school on that Friday and eliminate the Monday, the 18th of June?
No.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I just, being new to this, do hours matters? You.
900
partial days?
Yes, 990 hours.
Okay, and is having Friday before Labor Day early release, is that a compromise for this situation with families to have?
No. It doesn't affect it, because you have to have both. So they would have had to, correct me when I go wrong, you have to have both 990 and 180,
right.
So you've already planned that.
So you couldn't erase that much?
No.
If you took away Friday?
Right.
But we can do it.
What happens if we have more than five snow days?
Do we cry.
We just keep going.
I believe the law and the contract goes to the 30th.
Yeah.
Wasn't it traditionally if you had more than five, you would actually go into your spring break?
I don't know. It is not. I think you have that choice, and that decision from the state is not made until after February vacation, after like the snow, Mr.
I mean, the main reason we put the five on there is so to remind everybody that's not really the last day of school. Don't make your trip out of town. They still do, but that's, you know, that's really to remind people that it's the last day of 180, and we add 5 days on so people recognize you're gonna have snow days.
But if you have
the state requires you go to the end of June, no matter what, and then it comes back to the school committee. So let's say we had four more snow days, we would have to come back to you to change the calendar to negotiate. It says that you can change in that kind of thing with the collective bargaining, mm-hmm. to give up the time. But that's it. It goes back to the school committee to change the calendar.
Once we enter.
The 12th is the last day of school, not the 18th.
So Bob,
the 18th is after 5 days of snow.
Bob?
Just a question. I mean, looks like it's set in stone to have that Friday and come back and have the last day on Monday. Of course, we're going to have snow days anyway. So about next year, the year after that, you know, if this is set in stone this year, but at least the following year, let's knock that Friday out. I mean, that's the section we're hearing is that, why are we going 2 days? Of course, it's probably going to be 3 days.
Yeah, well, I don't know where Labor Day comes next
year. Why don't you do a survey before you knock it out?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
We're making up our minds for the district.
And just to note, my school district was supposed to get out a half a day on the 12th. We're now a full another week plus a couple days. We're not getting out until Wednesday, so you never know.
Is there a policy that has to start on Wednesday the 30th? I mean, why can't we start on the 28th, Monday?
They do
start.
The teachers do.
Move the teachers up.
That might be by contract. I believe their contract says they can't start before the 26th or something. There's a contract.
Wednesday before Labor Day.
There's a contract.
Wednesday before Labor Day.
And that must be the students.
Yes.
Because they're starting now. Yes, sir.
I would move ahead with it, obviously, with the schedule we have right now, and I do like the fact of having consistency of just snow day or not, keep everybody's plan.
Are you asking to move the question?
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
But
the question has
from the elementary.
Yeah, I don't have the power to move it because you guys are talking about Frontier, but.
So I move the question for Frontier, please.
Thank you.
So we do have to vote separately.
Yes, I will move the question.
Yes, so we have to vote separately.
Yes, we do.
Okay, so this is our roll call vote. So Cindy Wimette, yes. Phil Cantor?
Yes.
Robert Decker?
Reluctantly, yes.
Damon Fosno?
Yes.
That sounds reluctant. Bill Marafizi is not here right now. Mary Raymond?
Yes.
Judy Pierce?
Yes.
Lynn Roberts?
Yes.
Keith McFarland?
Yes.
William Smith?
No.
Bob Hulla?
Yes.
And it passes.
And I will take a roll call vote also on the Union 38 side. Elaine?
Yes.
And Jan isn't here. Ashley?
Yes.
Doug?
Yes.
Greg?
Gregory?
Yes. I hear yes. David?
Yes.
Ken, yes. Trevor?
Yes.
Don?
No.
Bob?
Yes.
Katie?
No.
Okay. That's Carrie.
Okay, moving on to the school committee calendar. You also had that in your packet if you were able to look it over, if anyone has any concerns.
They were in the packet that she sent out last week. They didn't hear anything about it, really.
Yeah, well.
I'll say that now.
So then it gets poked.
They can tell me what they think.
Do I have a motion from Frontier for the school committee calendar, please? Can I have a motion and then we can discuss it?
Motion.
I got a motion from Mr. Phil Cantor. Can I have a second?
Second.
Sir? Judy seconded it. And so, Kenny, you're on.
Yes, can I have a motion on the school committee calendar for Union 38?
So moved.
Second.
Bob, thank you.
So now we can discuss.
My question is, we typically meet on the second Tuesday of the month. The November meeting is the 7th, according to this, by reading from it says. And we typically meet the second Tuesday of the month.
Probably because the Sunderland's on the 2nd.
It's because of the holiday on the 3rd week that we pushed the two up. So we pushed Conway and Sunderland up a week, and then we pushed Frontier up a week because the 3rd week is a holiday week. Well, it's not a holiday week, but it is certainly Thursday. We're not going to be here.
Conway.
Oh, yeah, you wouldn't have meetings either. Not right now, that week.
So. Right. So it makes sense.
Selection.
Yeah. This. Anybody else? Okay, so for Frontier, all those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
And for Union, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Was that opposition?
No, I
was just waiting in response to the.
I was late. Sorry.
He's trying to write and do at the same time. So we're moving up to reviewing the 1-year contract with Dupree Law Offices.
You'll see. Oh, Judy has a question.
Do I have a second on that so we can discuss
second.
It? That's for Frontier. Kenny.
And for the Union, we have a motion.
Who?
Yes.
Trevor,
move it.
And a second?
Second.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know who. I'm sorry. You want to speak?
These contracts with Dupree, they actually, this is pretty much a notification, but they are our legal counsel. They pretty much represent most of the schools in Western Massachusetts. And I can speak to the fact that I call them 4 or 5 times a week. And there's always something. And he responds. I've had phone calls with him at 8:30, 9:30 at night. They're great. And they're helping us through some, a lot of, some litigation and some certainly guiding us as we talk about the Waitley meeting, the Waitley building. I'm sorry, I got confused. Christian Lane. So they're helping us as we go through releasing the Christian Lane property back to the
So, question?
Yes.
Who is his client?
The Frontier Regional School District, the school committee, actually, the school district and the union school
so,
district.
So shouldn't our agreement with him say who the correct client, I mean, when he gets the client wrong in the agreement, does that supposed to fill me with confidence?
Well, I'm representing the...
Phil is correct.
It just says Union 38, we're not in
there. It actually should be five different agreements, because...
It's the agreements between Union 38 and him.
Each school committee is a legal entity by itself. So it really should be five different agreements. They all should combine so that we don't pay...
It's $550 a month for the four union schools.
And then $550 for Frontier.
So if we changed it to read Frontier Regional School District and Union, Frontier Regional and Union 38 School Districts.
There's two different ones.
There's
two different contracts.
Never mind.
Or you didn't go far enough?
Oh, sorry.
Okay, so
$550 a month.
We withdraw the question. And apologies, we've been voting. There is no motion needed on this. My bad. Kenny's bad for following me. Sorry, we were just having that discussion. It's already been done. There's no vote needed for this tonight. It was just informational. So you withdraw your motion. Thank you, Bob. Thank you. So let's get to the last one. So the superintendent, we now have to evaluate a new superintendent. We didn't do this last year because Marty was leaving. So she said, I'm not doing this. And we said, okay. So Dr. Perry is going to present. You have your books, and she will walk us through it.
Yes.
She told me quickly, and then she will tell you what you have to fill out and the time span to get them back to the chairs. You have that? Which is a month. So we can present in May.
So you open your binders. We'll start very quickly. You'll see that there's an introduction. It's just an introduction of the kinds of things that I've been doing with the standards and the goals. And it's just more information about what I have found since I've been working here, what I've been doing, and getting to know people and getting to know the system. When I think back to a year ago, when it was pouring like this and I was interviewing, in the rain and the elevator and everything, and I will tell you, I am just as worried tonight about that rain, because one of these panels actually fell and broke and collapsed everywhere. I'm sure Darius will tell Frontier Regional after, but I am just as worried tonight as I was last year about the rain. But I'm also, you know, concerned as I was last year that you would get to know me and that you would find that I'm doing a very good job. I'm working hard. I think I've adjusted well. I think that I have gotten to know many of the stakeholders, and I have worked my way through helping other people compromise and working with my administrative team. They've been very helpful, helping me to be successful. So you will see, the first thing I put in there is the central office relocation project. That, of course, happened my very first morning at work, 8 o'clock, my very first day on the job, July 5th, we had a meeting, and we have many things to consider. This, you'll see a narrative on what happened. This one in the newspaper, it was also on our website. And then the PowerPoint that I presented and a lot of the thinking that went into it. I need to let you know that the transition was very smooth. It went off without a hitch. People seem to be happy. We've adjusted well to the new building. It is a lot cleaner. It's a lot more efficient. It's been great for us to really be surrounded by students. I get food from the cafeteria every day. The life skills students come in and visit me. I'm really enjoying being in the building. So that's just some data that talks about a lot of time and effort and planning went into it with Bob Lesko, Patty Kavanaugh. We worked really hard to make sure that the money was there and things were lined up, and it really went smoothly. So I was glad. and I know you are too. So superintendent goals, these are my, actually I have 8 goals, but I just put 7 because I wanted to not be a show.
Not sound like an overachiever.
Yeah, right. So you will see each goal listed. I've listed them, and then the next page after the introduction on the superintendent's goal is your feedback to me on how well I did my goals. This next chart are the goals that I presented to you in October, and then you'll see each goal with a narrative, the benchmarks and what happened and how I met them and how I continue to work on them. Goal 2, again, you'll see the same thing, the narrative, some examples of what we do, examples of the visits that I've made and the networking that I do. Goal 3, the training that I've had from the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents, DESE, the new superintendent induction program, Massachusetts Association of School Committees, the Connecticut Valley Roundtable, and several other trainings and meetings that I've been to. I did not put in there, but I am going to the next Rural Schools meeting, which is taking place at Pathfinder Regional, and that will be April 11th next week. So I am working with the Rural Schools Coalition to see what we can do politically to get things moving. So after, you'll see a lot of pages too of my own notes, just so you know. Effective classroom evaluation, I put some artifacts in there. Meetings with principals, I meet with the principals, I meet with the curriculum directors. We meet as a full administrative team. So we have several meetings a month. Management and operations, you're going to see a complete safety crisis plan that was actually done in Conway Grammar School by Kristen Gordon and her team, Trooper Carmichael, and so they put together this great crisis plan because we didn't have one in the district. We have a set of rules or a set of procedures, but no real thorough crisis plan, and the hope is that we'll be able to adopt this for each building in the district. Some other safety stuff that we're working on. Goal 7, we were talking about the PD. There's another list of the PD that is happening, and last year's and this year's proposed. And the surveys, you'll have copies of the surveys that the families get and the faculty. Goal 8, you'll see, again, the new student information system, PowerSchool. It's actually revising the elementary report cards, and this is a great deal of work. Calibrating things like MET Plus, approaching mastery. It's not the old ABC, you know, you count the numbers and then you get whatever average you get. It's very hard, and you'll see that there's been notifications to families. This, of course, is being led by, during the professional development time, by Louise Law, and it shows different rubrics, different standards for reading levels, and testing, and so that's just interesting stuff. And I have to tell you that these things, again, are not just individual things. There's a whole team behind everything. So when you get to the superintendent evaluation, there's 4 standards that you judge me at. The under standard 1, you'll see your sheet to fill out. For every, you'll see where it has the standard instructional leadership, 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, 1E. You'll see that I have given some background information for each portion of or each category. So 1A, you'll have a narrative on curriculum, ensuring that instructional staff design effective and rigorous curriculum. And then 1B, instruction, 1C, assignment, 1B, evaluation, data. And then you'll see several items behind that are artifacts of assessments, artifacts of, again, what we're doing with the, our curriculum program, and you'll see that. So standard two is management and operations. Again, the first page is the page you get to fill out on me, and then again, 2A, 2B, and onward. And there's a narrative for 2A to 2E, and you can read how I have addressed each one of these items in my, and with artifacts. And then the same thing for standard three, family and community engagement. There's a chart for you to fill out, and you will see many, again, narratives that speak to that, all the different evening activities I've engaged in, communications, a copy of all my superintendent's messages to the community, a note from one of the neighbors. Unfortunately, a lot of my interaction with stakeholders in the district, I can't talk about because they called me. Nobody's really called me yet to say you're really wonderful, but they call me a lot and say I have a problem over here and over there, and I know, and so I can't really talk about it, but I deal with it, and so far so good. So, and again, standard four, professional culture, and you'll see how I've addressed those. I also left a copy of the speech I gave the first day of school to the entire staff and faculty, and a final note. And my final note, again, tells you that it is a collective. This is, there's no way that this district would be as great as it is without all the other people behind us, behind me, doing all of these different things. And so I'm leading a ship, but there's so many sailors behind me that it's great.
Questions?
Bob?
It's my understanding that these evaluations are public documents.
Yes, they are.
Going back 2 years ago, we did it if you could drop them. It was before the May meeting.
Correct. We generally ask that the evaluations be completed, and you try and get them back to us in time for the May meetings.
So maybe in 2 weeks, whatever that date is, we can pick a date. And then it gives Kenny and I 2 weeks to kind of coordinate that. Yeah.
Board of Information, is, this is a very comprehensive presentation, mm-hmm. and I really think that the people in the district, parents and everything else, probably, you know, we should put it on a website for people to want to look at the self-evaluation and all these things, so everybody will understand the comprehensive part.
We could ask that it was put on their website, their front
yeah.
page,
yeah.
easily accessible through the
yeah.
front page.
So, did that, be accomplished or just wasn't.
Lynn? Yes.
Yes.
Sorry, can I ask a question?
No, you can't ask a question. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Well, I'm sorry you're in the public. And we had our public moment. And I'm sorry, but if we let a public person.
She's asking a question, I think, about this specific.
This
topic.
Is really
I think
important.
You can allow it.
I'm just going to take a quick vote. Anybody have any problem with her asking a question?
No.
Okay. Good.
Go ahead.
I'm not sure what you said. I'm Kristen Gordon, the principal of Conway Grammar School. But I thought maybe you said putting this on the website, which I think is wonderful. I would just ask that you not put the crisis plan for Conway Grammar School in any public area.
Well, I would think that
that's my only request.
That's a very good idea. That's mm-hmm. covered.
Thank you.
Yeah. For security purposes.
This is a state act. This is not a tool that we developed as opposite.
No, right. We didn't develop
correct.
This
is a standard thing that the state of Massachusetts uses to evaluate superintendents.
This is a standard state format for the evaluation of the superintendent of schools. So as she has pointed out, she's actually, I mean, within this document, you have the superintendent's performance goals, which I don't think is part of the state. Is it?
I don't know.
Sure doesn't look
the
like
the state law says the superintendent shall be evaluated.
Right. But this document, I have moved back to just in front of my standards, so I don't forget to fill it out. I just want to caution people, please don't forget, as you're going through, to find the superintendent's goal, performance versus her goals, which are in the front end of the document. They're superintendent's goals, it's about the third page in, second or third page, B4 or B8. So, page 4 or 8 on the superintendent's goals.
Goals are different than standards.
Right. So, but we need you to fill these documents out, make your check marks. Cindy and I then put them on to, painfully enough, a spreadsheet format so that we've got sort of a scoring system relative to how the grades are put for each of the standards and ratings within the evaluation. We then try and put that into a summary. Cindy does it for the Frontier Regional School. I do it for the individual schools. And I try and give the breakdown by school as well.
Phil?
So this was sent to us by PDF format. If you resend this to us in the DOCX or a similar WordPerfect or whatever format, we could then do it online and send.
Well,
do it electronically
would have to be something
and send it back.
From Donna. I can tell you.
So can you ask Donna to resend the evaluation in a format that we could return it electronically?
I think that's what we did a couple of years ago, and then you just email them to us and then
right.
Or you can drop them off at the school.
But we can't do that with a PDF.
Donna can.
And it's just the rating sheets that would be.
Yeah.
That Donna needs to not
the whole document. But we want to make sure that.
I think maybe they can go through that and take care of that.
Actually, it wasn't. I don't even know.
I understand that this is, you know, what we have to do, and it's the way the process is set up for evaluating superintendent, which obviously is a good thing. But I just not so sure we're the best evaluators in terms of for your reflection of. Really, what's going on in the district and how you're doing? I just wondered if you have thought about building in sort of a typical 360 type of thing where you provide some mechanism for teachers, principals, staff.
As you will read, I did a 360 with the principals.
Okay.
And as I wrote, they were overwhelmingly positive. It was really overwhelming. I was thrilled. The one thing that came out was, it's funny, either I listen too much and I don't say enough, or I'm not listening enough. So I'm trying to balance that. But everything else, yeah, it was. It's a very hard thing to do as well, is to have a 360 done. But I did.
You don't have that page?
Yeah. The one that you're talking about, I don't know.
Really?
I don't have. I don't know if anybody else.
Is it E4 B8?
Right under goals.
Sure,
right under
goals.
It's this one here.
Yeah. All right. And then
no,
the
next
tab.
For that one.
It's on her summary.
No, it's in the.
It was right after.
Yeah,
the intro to the superintendent's goal.
You don't have it.
He doesn't have it. Okay.
So we'll just have to get him.
No, she
sends
it on the.
That's why you need to come up.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that missing. I'm glad that I moved it and we found out that it's missing from some of the evaluations.
It's all going to get resent to us.
We can have Donna send the 5 pages.
Yeah,
actually. Yes.
So, do you want to ask a
question?
Oh, I'm sorry. This is the first time we're going through this. 5 pages that you need to fill out and return. And what is the process after you get all the information? So, I do believe it's the law that all of your comments are then taken, correlated, printed. We get that printout. You can have that printout. The printout goes on the website. And all we're doing is we're just putting it all together. We are not removing any comments. We are not adding any comments. We don't do that. We are just putting everything together and by simple addition, saying what the tally is. That's all it is. We have no authority to have an opinion on it, except for our own opinion when we write our own performance goal. But keep that in mind that every single thing you write will be for everyone else to read. The only thing we don't have to do is put your name on it. We just have to write.
What?
We just have to put the comments. But what?
if I mail you these five,
then
you email, that's it.
No, I...
If I email those five back to the office, whoever collects that email...
No, you email to me. You email to me.
See, that's why I want to make sure that nobody else gets eyes on what I write and this thing exactly.
Correct. And then actually, I do give that, we do give all that information to the superintendent. We turn that over to her.
Not...
Right. But the public sees your comments, the public doesn't... I do not believe the public sees your name, but I will double check on that and get back to you. Because Mr. Desta was shaking his head, yes, I'm sure the public sees your name.
Having come from the Republic of Amherst.
Thank you.
And so... So there is...
Hell in first state, but...
Okay, so just to clarify, then...
I mean, you can double check, but we were required to have our names on...
You were,
on all, okay. All documents regarding this.
Because I think when I put them together last year, I just took everybody's comment and put it under standard one and then standard two and then just gave the paperwork over.
Yeah, we could have come
but if I have to put names, that's what they do. Yeah, but you're going to send it to the email on who it is.
There's a place for comments down the bottom of each of the pages.
There's no place to send it.
Oh, no.
So if I mail this to her, to Conway, in a plain brown envelope, she's going to hold it.
I am so going to do this. Process of elimination of all those names. Yeah.
If everybody doesn't have a name, we will fill the mail out of sprinkler.
Patty?
Just a point of clarification. Those binders are public information because they were handed out to you, so I think we need to collect the crisis plan out of them before we leave tonight. Yes.
Okay.
Otherwise, they become public information.
Yes. Correct. Thank you.
We might have been in the executive session talking.
No, you cannot talk about the superintendent's evaluation.
No,
no,
no.
Oh, my goodness.
So anybody else, if you
yeah, I mean, just following up on what David said, I mean, I think, I agree, like, it would be, I think the most helpful thing in evaluating would be seeing some of the feedback on that from administration and teachers and staff and, like, you know, and so if it was possible, I realize this is already a big process and to add work, but, like, if there was a, even if we found people who were willing to be on, like, a subcommittee that collected that from administration, you know, basically the same questionnaires we're getting, and getting that from administration, teachers, staff, would work, you know, and try to collect that for us to see. And I think it would be useful for you and for us, because a lot of this stuff, I don't know, I'm not involved with you in that role at all, really. And so then it's just, the, you know, as artifacts go, a key artifact would be, well, those people, what are the people who are, you know, you're administering, what are they, you know, what's their feedback?
I mean, in the past, correct me if I'm wrong, but if you don't understand the question or you have no idea anything about it, you just leave it blank.
It's not that.
But if you're trying to answer the question by seeing what somebody else says, that's not what you're thinking.
Well, but leading, being a leader in the building, being a, you know, these are a lot of the criteria are things like that. I guess the key artifact, like I said, the key artifact would be what is the feedback from the people you're leading.
So that's kind of how you're going to answer the question then, by.
I'm saying
by finding out from somebody else. I mean, if you can't answer, I mean, I'm just saying, in the past, if you can't answer a question, then you take that into consideration when you're filling out the answers, the total and stuff, right? Correct?
Yes. So, let's just move on, Phil.
So I understood Doug's comment to be sort of a request for the entire staff to fill out evaluations of the superintendent in this format, and I think that's a good idea.
The time that it would take to formulate that and get that going, we would not get this done this year, and we need to.
I'm not suggesting for this year.
Yeah, so just that can be going clear. Forward. Keep in mind that we didn't do this last year, and then, you know, so it's not that we're that good at it. So I think tweaking and making that recommendation, but I think how I was taking that and how he was taking it is that you wanted that for this year.
Sorry.
No, I guess Cindy, my point was that Doug, it's the same point, but it's that Doug's, that I don't think that suggestion has ever been made before. I've never heard it, and I've never thought that was good, and I'd like to see that done for next year.
Yeah.
It's kind of a two-part thing, and I think you touched on this two parts. One part, Lynn, is just for your sake, just for you to have it. It's not necessarily a question of us. Second part question is, in the future years, is that something we would use as just a factor in evaluation? But I think the main part is to help your self-evaluation so you know. You don't even need to share it with us necessarily. That was sort of the main impetus, to get a better sense of what's going on for you to be a better leader.
Let me explain. The union principals have a survey. The Union 38 principals, the teachers and the IAs survey of the principal. And the principal gets information, but it's their information to help them. They don't, they don't advertise it. They don't share it. They don't put it out there. It's just for them to look at and to grow from. In my position as a superintendent, it's always nice to hear what people think about you, staff, IAs, but. To me, what I need to know is what my principals are thinking, or what they are sensing from me. It's very hard when you're at the top and you've got the 30,000-foot view. I'm not always saying yes. There's times I have to say no. People don't understand that. And many, many teachers, I don't have any personal. I go in the classrooms, I say hello, I congratulate them on things that they've done well. I meet with the IA union reps once a month. I'm out there and I'm meeting people, but I don't have any direct impact on a lot of teachers. Because there's a chain of command, I have an impact with the curriculum people and what they're putting out there in the schools. I have a direct link to the principals and what they're doing with their staff. But I don't have a direct link.
It's not a question of a link. I think Lynn, you have an incredible impact on faculty. That's the main sort of workforce. All I'm suggesting is as a tool for you, just like you said, the principals get it and they just use it themselves. I'm just saying it may be a positive thing.
Sure.
It's just extra information and extra stuff to help with sort of self growth and stuff. It's a separate thing from getting that information to us. I mean. Obviously, we look at it and it's raw data. We're like, well, what are they complaining about? And there's something great here. It's not about our thing at this point. It was much more saying, just I think if you're going to take all this self-evaluation, that's another important thing to know. Wow, what do the faculty think about how the district's doing and what I'm doing and how my policies are working? That's not something to push away.
I have made a note for next year to investigate and then create a survey of the superintendent by the staff, the faculty, and the administration, and or you could say by all union employees, which includes cafeteria people and everything. And then that way we can charge the superintendent or the principal or whoever we can charge as a committee to make that survey, and then to bring that to us, and then to have that survey given to the staff and the employees. We can also ask for a survey of parents and of students. That is totally within our realm to do that. So if that's something that we're interested in pursuing for next year, that sounds like a good thing. First it was Keith, I'm sorry, and then Mary, and then you.
Can we just put it on for discussion next year? Because it's already 8:00. And
yeah, I know.
There's a lot to be said about this, and often people that respond to surveys are either people that are pissed off at the
right.
superintendent, had a negative thing,
right.
or, love her. So I'm not really sure. And the more you survey people, it's just...
Well, what I'm hearing is there needs to be further discussion.
I think further
Keith?
Discussion is necessary.
The only thing that I would say is a teacher in my enchantment, and they mentioned I deal with my department head, I deal with my principal, and the superintendent's way off. I don't want to deal with the superintendent, but if this gets too confusing or it's too dense and you want, how is she doing? It's incumbent on all of us to talk to the building principals that other faculty we represent. And that's where you can get the most information.
Mary?
I'll
wait. Oh, okay. So, I don't know if you have your calendar out, but if we could have these maybe by the 28th, which is the last Friday in April, maybe the rest of the month of April, and then it'll give us 10 days to kind of get it together for me anyways, it would be May 9th, I believe, is our next meeting.
So
that sounds okay.
So if, for Frontier, sooner or later than, as soon as better than later, but by the 28th. And I have all your emails.
Waitley's meeting is May 1st.
Waitley meet, okay, so Waitley, you would be, where's Waitley? You guys would be going first. So I don't know when you would want that by, Kenny.
I'd rather have it earlier than that. I have a board, I'm preparing for a board meeting on the 28th, so I wouldn't have much time that week. I mean, I barely have time, I would barely have time that week, so if I could have it at the beginning of the week, that would be preferred. 24th.
24th is Monday.
Mm-hmm.
So even by the 21st of April, that way you're not putting it aside thinking I've got time, then you need to get to it. So ASAP.
Great.
But by 21st.
21st
yes.
Would be great.
We'll do 21st, so we'll both be on the same page.
That'll be Friday the 21st.
21st for us. If you could write it down, Friday the 21st.
Done.
And then it gives us, yeah, it gives us two solid weeks, or it gives me two solid weeks.
Okay. Thank you. I also would like to remind everyone, we've only been here like 8 months, so.
We don't care.
How long people would go into goal number 6 and pull these and pass them down this way, please?
Do you want the whole thing?
Let's take goal number 6 out.
It's goal number 6.
The whole statement on it is really necessary. I mean, it's really, I just looked through it, the whole.
Just save the first page and give us all the rest of the documents and
it's really only the lockdown stuff that needs to come out, right?
I'm just going
to
give it all to you.
Well, I think if you've got all the procedures for various happenings in the school, I understand the lockdown is the primary focus, but I think it's just a good idea.
It's just the packet that says crisis plan.
Yeah.
And I'll use them because I will be passing them
say
out.
Say what you want out of that section, but don't pick.
At our four town safety meeting. Guy,
superintendent's report. You have paperwork.
Thank you. This is the season of performances, and Frontier Regional and Union 38 schools have an amazing amount of talent to share with our communities. First, I'd like to quote Principal Ben Barshevsky's message to the Union 38 schools today about the musical magic of our students. Ben wrote, "The past two nights, Frontier Regional has played host to two wonderful musical events, Bandfest and the Spring Strings and Sing Concert. On Tuesday evening, April 4th, our band teachers, Max Sherrill and Megan Carr, provided our community with a fantastic grades 4 to 12 band concert. It was quite evident that Max and Megan spent a lot of time and energy collaborating to make BandFest such a special evening. The grand finale, when all the district band members from grades 4 to 12 combined forces to play the 1812 Overture, was truly inspiring." That's my comment. This evening provided our elementary students with a sense of excitement and possibility and will undoubtedly help to keep them motivated going forward. The following night, our Union 38 Strings teacher, Mary Jo Sherrill, led our 3rd to 6th grade students in a stirring strings performance. In her first year as a strings teacher for our district, Mary Jo has brought our elementary strings program to a new level. Last night's events were capped off with a special performance by the Deerfield and Conway Schools Select Chorus of grade 5 and 6 students led by Janet Ryan. The future is clearly looking very bright for these programs. Thank you, Max, Megan, Mary Jo, and Janet for your wonderful work. In addition to these two outstanding events just this week, I would also like to speak about the amazing musical Guys and Dolls that took place in March. As the first Frontier Regional School musical in 20 years, this show set high standards for professional performances, including pitch-perfect singing and amazing solos. Again, thank you to Max Sherrill and David Peck. The Frontier Regional Annual Telethon was another fabulous event. The talent of our students and that of our local community is beyond compare. And with the added excitement of raising approximately $9,000, it was a true success. Thank you to David Fatale for serving again as Master of Ceremonies and all the students who performed for the community. Another enjoyable event was the Conway Jump Rope Show, a truly student-led creative performance that combined athletics, dance, and ingenuity. Thank you to Arlene Mikolajczyk, Conway's physical education teacher, for volunteering during her lunchtime three times a week since November to coach and inspire these students. Our out-of-school time program is sponsoring a girls' robotic challenge this Saturday, April 8th, open to all girls in Union 38 schools. This program was developed by Jody Massa from the out-of-school time program in Conway. It involves providing girls with the opportunity to work in a team-oriented environment to build excitement in the mathematics, science, engineering, and technology fields. They not only learn about robotics and engineering, they gain confidence as team members and leaders and are motivated to be curious and open to learning something new. They design robots, assign tasks to the robots, while they are learning about the programming behind making the technology work. 12 to 14 community members, including our IT director, all the out-of-school time site coordinators, teachers, and parents have volunteered to make this event successful. These events are the best part of being the superintendent. All of these events require countless volunteer hours from our many stakeholders. We cannot thank them enough for all they give to our children. I'm looking forward to the Whately Elementary School play on May 10th, the Sunderland Elementary School concert on May 31st, the Conway Grammar School spring concert on June 1st, and the Deerfield Elementary spring concert on June 2nd. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? Go ahead. Yeah.
Motion.
Do I have a second from Frontier to adjourn?
Yes.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
For Frontier, all those in favor?
Second.
Opposed?
Jeez, I don't even get the second.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I was supposed to vote before you.
You have a second for the union motion.
It's the last one you have to worry about, Corman.
All in favor?
Aye.